Hello everybody, Doug Underhill, County Commissioner from District 2, and welcome to Underhill's Updates. And honestly, every month that we do these things, we ought to do them on the same two subjects all the time, public safety and infrastructure, because honestly, that's our job. There are a lot of other things that county commissioners do, and you oftentimes think about, you know, call the commissioner's office for this, that, or the other. But the truth of the matter is, our job is to make sure that the infrastructure of this county works properly and that we oversee how your money is spent to make sure that it's going to infrastructure and public safety. And then if there's something left over after we've done those two things, then we can talk about other things. But today, we're talking about infrastructure and public safety. When I ran for county commissioner, the promise that I made was that I was going to focus my attention on the core issues and the core of the district. So much of our time and money had been spent on a four-lane fantasy out on Perdido Key that, quite frankly, most of the folks out there didn't want. It was going to cost $100 million. $100 million. Can you imagine what we could do right here in Warrington with $100 million? Well, it doesn't take $100 million to fix something like this right behind us. This is Navy Boulevard. This is the, this is Main Street of the West Side, isn't it? And for too long, this area that we're standing in right now has been neglected while all of our energy is spent toward promoting urban sprawl. Sprawl up into the north of the county, sprawl out to the southwest sector. If you don't take care of the core though, eventually the entire organism is going to collapse. So for the last 3 years, we've been focusing on a lot of stormwater and transportation issues here in the core of the district. Today we're going to be talking about Navy Boulevard and the roads project here. We're also going to be talking with some of my cohorts at the ECUA about a lot of the infrastructure associated with stormwater management and also with sewage. Not the cleanest and most exciting thing to talk about, but it's really is the business of the government. It's what you pay your taxes for, and you expect these things to work. So come on, let's go on this journey. So we're sitting here with David Forte from Public Works. He's basically one of our road gurus down here at the county. And so rather than me just tell you as a politician what's going on, I would actually prefer for you to get it straight from the horse's mouth. So David, right behind us, Navy Boulevard, that we've got the Navy Boulevard corridor plan, actually predates me as a county commissioner. This is something that the county was already working on. Tell us quickly, why are we doing it? What's it going to look like behind us when we're done?
Absolutely. So this is a long time coming for the area. I know that the locals in the Warrington community have been looking forward to this for a very long time. Myself, it's been since 2010 since we've been working on this plan. We're currently at the phase where we're expecting design, and actually, so now we're getting out of the conceptual phases and actually getting to where you actually start seeing some what the actual roadway will look like upon construction. The intent is to make this as safe and as functional as a roadway as possible. But also work as a beautification project as well. So you're kind of hitting all facets of transportation.
So what kind of things for beautification? What are we looking at?
Obviously, we're going to be looking at additional landscaping throughout the corridor. We're looking at all pedestrian and cycling type amenities, from bike lanes to additional sidewalks, clear delineation from where the roadway is to the sidewalks. Right now, it's kind of difficult to delineate.
If you even can. You got what, four lanes of traffic plus that suicide turn lane in the middle that goes right into the parking areas. Now, we improved those last year, the year before that. We got all that paved because we had a lot of stormwater runoff.
Correct.
But, it's just one big strip of asphalt from the door of one business all the way across the road to the next one.
Absolutely.
So, is there it's my understanding that the FDOT actually, this is FDOT owned road, right?
That is correct.
And they own all of the right-of-way essentially from one building to the next.
Essentially. Primarily the entire quarter, that's correct. There are some areas where you have some private, and so that's where it kind of gets a little funky determining which one is whose and whatnot. Yeah. So we, the county, we understand the residents and the property owners' desires for the corridor, so we've actually taken it upon ourselves to really spearhead this project. And move forward, but the department has, or FDOT has actually taken over management of the project. We hope to see additional green space in the area, as some additional amenities for the area, mm-hmm. and a way to try to just beautify the area and try to just foster development and growth in the entire Warrington community.
Yeah, that's pretty cool, because I know that we've had a lot of town hall events, you know, starting with, I think there were some before I was a commissioner. We've definitely had quite a few since then. What are the things that we're really paying attention to with regard to the businesses here on Navy Boulevard in terms of making sure that we don't have any impact on them during construction or once it's finished?
True. So there's been numerous workshops and actually individual one-on-one stakeholder meetings where we actually had each and every property owner along the entire corridor actually invited within the entire Warrington community redevelopment district in the past, where we sat down with each individual and said, what would you want to see in the future? What is it about the past that you want to kind of like resurrect in a way to just make this overall safer and better community? And so we met with each individual property owner along the corridor. They told us what their businesses do and don't do, what they like to see, and we're taking all that in consideration for the design of the project.
You know, it's funny too, because I think a lot of times when citizens have, they go to these meetings and, you know, we want to have your input, and then they have their input and people don't have a sense. They're like, you didn't listen to a thing I said. Now, obviously, everybody can't have everything that they want, but I have watched this process, the plan, I've actually watched it evolve with every single one of those meetings, because ultimately, without the support of the Warrington business community, first of all, but then the greater Warrington community, the project has no chance of success.
Absolutely.
And one of the reasons why that is with this is because, although it's a state road, who's paying for this?
It is a county locally funded project with LOST, or local option sales tax dollars.
Yep. And so that's something that people, I want you to understand, is as the discussion comes up about where our LOST money is going to go, we've spent, in our minds, we've spent that LOST about 10 times over. So it's very important, and this is, you know, every single citizen should be watching what their commissioner's doing with the LOST money, because there are way too many needs for the amount of money that we have. But I'll tell you that for me, for District 2, this is absolutely a priority, because there won't be a rebirth of the business district of Warrington without us focusing on the infrastructure.
Absolutely.
The private sector is not going to invest its money. In fact, I mean, you see that we're actually at a business that is actually trying to invest their money, but they're having to spend so much money on things like stormwater management, septic tanks, you know, and offsite improvements, that it's just hard to invest money in Warrington, harder than it should be. So with us investing in the infrastructure and doing our job, it should free up the private sector to be able to invest in it. So without them on board and a part of the process, then it's going to be very hard to finish it out. But I will tell you that for myself, there are very few LOST priorities that exceed this one for me. As soon as we're done talking about the road, we'll actually be talking with some of the elected officials from ECUA about stormwater management and sewer. You know, because much of this area that we're standing in now, built up business district, people would be amazed to find out that many of these businesses are still on septic tanks. Talk about not meeting your basic infrastructure. So we're on a good track. Thank you very much. And
absolutely,
as soon as we get the infrastructure part done, I think you're going to see just an expansion of private sector investment here that's going to be just going to blow your mind.
Couldn't agree more.
So thank you very much.
Thank you, Commissioner.
All right, so now we're standing here on New Warrington Road. We're out in front of what used to be Yamato's. It's about to become David's Catfish House. We just got word that it's going to open up here in a couple of weeks, so pretty excited about that. A prime example of a business that a private investor, private sector, investing in Warrington. And we're standing here now with Lois Benson, ECUA representative from District 2, to talk a little bit about what ECUA is doing to invest in the infrastructure. So Lois, thanks so very much for coming out.
Oh, thank you for inviting
Perfect
me.
Perfect day to be out in Warrington,
oh,
quite frankly.
Oh, is it wonderful. You know, when we moved the Main Street plant, everyone said the growth is going west. That's a natural direction. And we have invested a lot on this side, but it's slow. So you're a great partner in increasing the infrastructure, getting us off of septic tanks and onto sewer system on the west side.
You know, it's funny because all the discussion about septic to sewer has cycled around the environmental aspect of it. But the reality is here, we're standing in the middle of the commercial district of Warrington.
Right.
And you can't talk to a company, a big company, a cyber company, we could practically throw a rock to Quarry Station from where we're standing. And you can't talk to a big cyber company about building a building here in Warrington when there's no sewer service.
That's correct.
There's so many of these businesses
yes.
that are on septic tank, and I get calls from them all the time saying, you know, if our septic tank fails, we are going to have to move our business out of Warrington because we can't afford to repair it. And so they're asking me, when is sewer coming to the business district of Warrington?
Yes, and our priorities are right in this area. We're looking at the commercial district of Warrington, we're looking at Navy Point, we're looking at the Bayou Chico area, because that's where they need sewer, that's where we need to get people off the septic. And you know, businesses don't want to come where people don't take care of their greatest asset, which is this beautiful place where we live, our waterways. If they see that our waterways are being fouled, they're not going to bring their people here and their jobs.
No, it actually sends a message that that you're not forward thinking.
Right.
It sends a message that you can't even take care of the basics, so how are you going to take care of our, you know, right, our industry or whatever, you know, particularly when you're talking about a tech industry like cyber. It's funny because there's so much tech going on here on the west side.
Yes.
And then in this dichotomy of all of this forward thinking, but we're still kind of like we've got one foot nailed in the past because of this infrastructure. So with regard to ECUA's priorities for the Triumph money, and which is designed for, you know, restoring our economy, right?
Right.
How does that look for us on the west side?
Oh, it looks very good for us. Right now, it is at the staff level, and they have proposed another number of projects. It will now go to the Citizens Advisory Committee, which will rank them, and then it will go to the board. But the staff recommendations are pretty much focused on the Warrington area.
One of the things I love about ECUA is the fact that you really do leverage that Citizens Advisory Committee.
Oh, absolutely.
You know, and it's not just a check in the box. Okay, well, we got to get the citizens' input. Check. No, it is always notable how much those citizen groups are involved.
Absolutely.
Throughout the process.
And we have people strongly advocating for Warrington on that body. So that's also very good. And a little plug. The collaboration between ECUA and the county is so critical, and thank you for all you do to advocate for that. I mean, when we go in and do sewer and you do stormwater, it is a huge benefit for all of these areas.
Well, that's that collective impact, right?
That's right.
You know, and it's so funny because it's not funny, it's actually a little depressing when you look at the past when the board and ECUA were at odds with one another. You know, everybody loses.
Everyone loses.
And the citizens were, you know, they weren't even listening to what we were arguing about. They were just saying, would you children get together and work it out?
Yes.
The citizens don't want to hear it.
No.
They really want to see is us work together. So,
yeah.
And that's been an important part of my, you know, and I have no political background. I know you're very politically experienced, but with no background coming into it, I just pray every day I can swim my lane and do my job really well. And count on other people to do theirs really well. And that model seems to be working out a lot better.
It is working a lot better. But, you know, we have joint projects ahead of us in Brownsville, which is another important commercial district of our community.
Well, the first commercial district, right?
That was
Main Street.
It was Main Street, and it's still an important part of our community that we have kind of pushed aside to chase growth to the north. And we can't do that. We can't throw away community.
Well, sprawl is incredibly expensive.
Very expensive.
You know, you're having to put in so much new infrastructure, and then you end up neglecting the old infrastructure.
Right.
In fact, when we're done talking here, we're gonna head out and I'm gonna be talking with Vicki out at the where all the new work is going in on Blue Angel Parkway.
Right.
I don't think people understand that as we spend money on new things, we're just increasing the burden that we have to maintain them.
That's right.
You know, if you go out and you buy. If you have five cars in your household, I say that because I've got teenage drivers now, your maintenance costs increase
right.
five times over
That's
having
right.
one car. And so as we grow, we're doing all this constant growth, but if we don't grow high density in the core of the district, then what we end up doing is just spreading ourselves so thin we can't take care of any of it. So I'm actually very excited to hear that District 2 is really coming to the forefront in terms of y'all's Triumph asks, because I mean I wish it was because we were forward thinking, but it's because this is the old part of town, this is the core,
right.
And it's really long overdue for getting that kind
yes.
of work.
And we have been chipping at it. You know, Navy Point is an example, a wonderful old neighborhood on beautiful waters, and little by little we've converted from septic to sewer, but it's been extremely slow.
Yeah.
But when you partner, it gets exponentially
It accelerates
faster.
It, absolutely.
Yes.
And you know what's funny is that people are talking, when they talk about the cyber jobs that are going in at Corey and at NAS, people are like, well, those people don't live on the west side. They're gonna get a house in East Hill. That's not true. So many of them that I hired on Corey live within 5 minutes of base. Communities like Lake Charlene, Twin Oaks, which is right behind us here, and Navy Point, are seeing this resurgence of activity. And you know you've got a healthy neighborhood when you see a mom pushing a toddler in their carriage and a 75-year-old walking on the same sidewalk.
Yes.
That is a dynamic neighborhood.
Absolutely.
And everybody in between, and they know each other, they're friend, they learn from each other.
Right.
When you see a neighborhood where that's happening, like Navy Point, you know it's happening correctly. Now, we have other neighborhoods here on the west side that we don't have that happening yet.
Right.
Myrtle Grove is one where, you know, if you don't have that reinvestment, if we're not revitalizing, then what happens is, as people age out of their neighborhood and they can no longer take care of their house becomes a rental.
That's right.
And so that should be a warning to all of us that if you don't do the infrastructure,
right,
you're going to lose your community.
And Myrtle Grove is such a wonderful community with people who raise their kids. Their kids have gone now, and they take care of their yard. They play by the rules. And then next door is a house that's just going downhill.
Mm-hmm.
And we all lose when that happens.
And so when they started a group called the Myrtle Grove Revitalization Group,
yes,
right?
Yes.
And I go in there, and you're thinking that you're going to hear, you know, say, what do we need to do in your neighborhood? And you think you're going to hear like these big, you know, high-end type of investment. They said, Commissioner, we need streetlights. We just put 701 streetlights in Myrtle Grove.
Oh, that's wonderful.
I mean, practically looks like a ballpark at night. And, you know, what I'm hearing is that Myrtle Grove residents are getting out and they're walking in the evening, especially with the weather we've had since the storm came through.
Yes.
They're going out and they're walking in the evening because they feel safe in their neighborhood.
Good.
And the more people that are on the sidewalk, the less likely it is that bad things are going to happen.
Right. It's eyes on the street, which
exactly.
is exactly, you can't have enough law enforcement. What you need are neighborhoods who notice something that's a little amiss.
Yep.
But it starts with us doing our job and creating the infrastructure that makes them want to live there and work there and play
yep.
there.
We prosper with the infrastructure, we fail without it. It's just that simple.
Right.
And so I'm really actually very excited about the fact that you said that ECUA is really looking at the west side and Warrington area in particular. But when you got out of your car, you had a map that
yes.
showed some of the work that you guys have already been doing
yes.
and
yes.
what's underway. So if you don't mind, can we just take a minute to kind
sure.
of go over that
Let's
map?
Look at it.
Okay.
Yes.
All right, Lois, tell me what we're looking at here.
Well, we're looking at, this is mostly on the west side,
mm-hmm.
the area we're talking about, and we're looking at some of the projects that we have accomplished so far. So you can see over, this is Star Lake, which was a citizen-initiated project.
Right.
Navy Point, we've done parts of Navy Point and on each side
mm-hmm.
of Navy Boulevard. This is the next part of Navy Point, which we are getting ready to do.
That's your phase four.
Yes. But what we have down here is all along this bayou that is still on septic tanks. And these, the septic tanks leach into the surface waters. It is very expensive because these houses get farther and farther apart. It's about $10,000 each to convert somebody to a new sewer line. So it's not something we can do tomorrow.
And the demographics in this area aren't such that the citizens can really stomach that themselves.
Exactly.
Yes. So that has to be something that there's some level of assistance
right.
on the public
right.
front.
And what we do is we waive the impact fees. We just, once we go in with sewer, all they have to do is connect from their home to the line that we've provided. So
okay.
it's fairly inexpensive
okay,
for
so
them
that,
to
yeah,
do.
Okay, so that helps take the sting out of it a little
yes.
bit. Because even though on a map it looks like those are waterfront communities, and certainly there's some really nice homes on the
sure.
on the water, these are working class people.
These are.
This is not a vacation area.
Right.
You know, this is really actually one of our oldest neighborhoods on the west side.
Yes, yes. We have done Edgewater, which is another neighborhood near surface waters, and it goes back to a community that doesn't take care of its greatest asset. The thing that brought us all here
right.
and keeps us here is our waterways and the wonderful people who live here. So that has been a priority of ECUA, and here's Inarrarity, which is another
yep.
area
so,
that's
so the purple here, those are kind of your next priorities,
exactly.
right?
Exactly.
And is it, I'm assuming it's not just by fate that they happen to be close to the waterways.
No, it is the policy of the ECUA to remove septic tanks from areas near surface waters.
As we come close to 2018, it's hard to really excuse having septic tanks right next to Absolutely. The waterways that our kids swim in, isn't
exactly.
it?
Exactly. Yes.
I mean, that might have made sense a generation ago, but you know, especially as we've become more dense, it's inexcusable,
right.
really.
And if we want to attract jobs to the west side, which is a natural, we need to take care of the other parts of the west side to make that happen. So it's not just the commercial districts, mm-hmm. it's the residential districts.
You know, Lois, one of the funny things that it was often said before I became a commissioner, the people here in Warrington said that, you know, those people out in Perdido, they get everything. It's just those, and actually when I was running and I introduced myself, they were like, oh great, another rich guy from Perdido, you know, uh-huh. what are you going to do for me? And it was like, I thought that was amusing because I'm an officer now, but I came in as an enlisted, so I certainly wouldn't call myself rich by any,
right.
we're sitting here on the hood of my Hyundai. For
yes.
But it was interesting to see how people had that perception that Perdido got everything. Whereas for those of us out in Perdido, if you ask what the priorities are there, they're going to tell you these roads coming into
yes.
our community. So
yes.
District 2 citizens are actually pretty much of one voice about where they think the priorities
yes.
are, and it's these areas here in the core of the district.
Right.
You know, so once we started kind of refocusing there, it's amazing how much public interest has come up.
Good.
You know, and when you
Good.
Invest in these neighborhoods, it's funny because now you go into Navy Point right now, and what do you see? The Navy Point homeowners group there, and you see their signs out in front of their houses. You see them actually taking ownership of their neighborhood
yes.
again. Myrtle Grove's doing the same thing. And I tell you what, I think that when we're done with the Beach Haven project, you know, and we tie in North Street and we put in curbs and gutters in a neighborhood that most people couldn't even tell you where that neighborhood is.
Right. But it's beautiful. I'm sure
yeah.
you've walked it. I've walked it.
I'd give anything for the oak trees
I know,
that they've got. As I don't
gorgeous.
Have those on my property.
Yes.
But I think that you're going to see even a neighborhood, you know, Beach Haven, that's essentially a forgotten neighborhood, I think you're going to see revitalization
oh,
there as well.
Yes.
You know, because the infrastructure is going in.
Right.
So I see out here, this is Treasure Hill Park right here, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And that's all still on septic.
Yes.
But the priority is here. That makes sense because
right.
this is really where the density of growth is
yes.
right now because
yes.
that's more or less built out.
Right.
So, okay.
You know, eventually we would like to see all of this on sewer.
Right.
Because there's so much surface area there. There is, this area is another beautiful area of town where we'd like to see. That's Navy Boulevard
mm-hmm.
and this is Bayou Chico. And gorgeous, gorgeous property, and
yeah.
we'd like to get them off of septic.
You know, and
as well.
I think it's funny that people, I didn't even realize, I mean, I knew that Bayou Chico was really important, but when I became a commissioner and had to start really getting into the brass tacks, if you want to clean up Bayou Chico, you have to start all through Jones Swamp.
Yes.
You have to look at Jackson Creek, which, you know, is right down the hill from us
right,
right here. You know, and so we're actually buying up a lot of land in Jones Swamp and Jackson Creek. And returning that to its natural state.
Wonderful.
Because the way that God designed it, you know, the land filters the water on the way
exactly.
to the waterway.
Yes.
All we have to do is kind of return it back to the original plan
yes.
a little bit
yes.
and not build in those waterways.
And it's appropriate that Triumph money, the result of the BP spill, goes to these kinds of things which were most affected by the BP
yeah.
spill.
But yeah, if you look at it you know, kind of spiritually, I guess, you know, BP happened because of a pursuit of money that put the environment at risk.
Yes.
So, you know, and it's funny, traveling around the world as a military man, what I saw was that the worst thing for the environment is poverty. Because
oh,
your poorest countries are the ones where they absolutely strip the land of its resources.
Yes.
So if you really want to truly protect the environment, people need to be prosperous.
Sure.
And the more prosperous people are, the more resources they have for protecting the environment. So it's funny, people, you know, try to, you know, it's either the environment or the economy.
No.
How can you think that way anymore? Because we now know that those two are so intertwined
yes.
that if one fails, the other is going to fail.
Well, and you look at Naval Air Station, which is so much a part and an economic engine of this community, and what happens when people retire is they want to stay on the west side and live there and have their
yep.
grandchildren come there. And so again, we owe it to those people who have fought for our country to make sure that this place is as worthy of having them here.
You know, and those retirees,
become the ones who are also, those are the volunteers that do,
right.
They've spent an entire career volunteering, mm-hmm. so they don't know how to say no.
Right.
They end up on your citizens advisory committees. Right. They end up, teaching your Cub Scouts and coaching your ball teams.
Yes.
It's one of the things that I just so much love about the West Side is that the fabric of a texture of who we are on the
yes.
West Side is so ingrained with the military
yes.
that, to just try to put a dollar figure to it is almost,
yeah.
You're still going to come up short
yeah.
in describing the value. So
they are the emissaries of our community.
Yeah, yeah. I'm so glad to see, and as you see the red grow,
yes.
that just tells you that dedicated commitment to fixing this kind of,
kind of
legacy problem on the South Side. So.
And we just had a hurricane. This is one area that was hit very hard by Hurricane Ivan.
I remember it well.
We've gone back in to that area of Grand Lagoon. And Sagenza Cove.
Mm-hmm.
So we're fortunately we don't have to do rebuilding from a hurricane this time, and we can gradually.
Yeah. Lois, one of the things that I've noticed with every single time that it rains here, Jonathan and I don't spend our time in the office. We're driving around the neighborhoods, and we've actually been slowly but surely implementing the activities that were identified in the Stormwater Action Team from 2014. Every single rain event, there are fewer and fewer buildings at risk. There are fewer areas of the road that are flooded over. We've still got some major things that need to be done, but we have really been kind of chipping away at this quite a bit. And it's very noticeable now where those last ones remain. And we're actually making very good progress on it so that even when they do come up, we still have Henderson Bayou that has a flooding issue. And I think people don't understand that when the stormwater management system fails, it fails into your sewer system.
It does.
So it's easy to complain about, ECUA had a spillage, but the spillage happened because we don't have enough stormwater management to keep the stormwater out of the sewer system. So, little by little, we are whittling away on that, and there's going to come a time where when we tell the kids about the 2014 flood, they're going to be like, how did that ever happen?
Right.
They're not going to believe us
right.
because the infrastructure will be so strong that it seems like a different country we're talking about.
Well, congratulations on that priority, because it's not sexy. Stormwater management is expensive, and people don't get excited about it.
There's no golden shovel moment or big scissors and all that kind of thing, but it's the work that they hired us to do.
Yes.
It's what the people really expect us to do.
Yes.
I honestly don't think they're very impressed with those big scissor opening moments and all that stuff.
No.
You haven't seen me doing a whole lot of those, but I'll certainly go out and run around in muck boots and look at anything that we can do to improve stormwater here, because there really is no excuse for us with all the technology on the West Side that a rainstorm shuts business down in Warrington.
Yeah.
That has got to be something that is no longer acceptable in Warrington.
Well, congratulations on all you're doing.
Thank you very much.
It's a pleasure to be a partner in it.
I appreciate it, Lois.
All right, so now we are standing just off of Blue Angel Parkway. We're at the Bayou Marcus for Reclamation Facility. For this part of the video, what I had planned to do was talk about infrastructure in Blue Angel Parkway and traffic. But the reality is everybody who's calling my office and asking, what they're asking about is, what are those pipes on Blue Angel Parkway? So rather than me tell you about it, I've got Vicki Campbell, District 1 representative for ECUA. So we're actually in District 1 now. And I thought, Vicki, it'd be a lot easier for me to just let you tell everybody what is going on with all those pipes all the way down Blue Angel Parkway.
Well, like you, I get those calls often. That's the main sewage effluent feeder from the southwest end of the county into our Bayou Marcus plant. And unfortunately, the first 13,000 feet of these pipes have degraded. And we are having to merely replace the pipes and put in some PVC pipe material. We put this was put down about 10 years ago, and it's it has a corrosive liner inside of it, but somehow that corrosive liner has failed. It has cracks in it, and the pipes underneath are deteriorating. So it's allowing sand to get in the pipes, and sand into our plant is a terrible thing, so disrupts all of our flow. Yeah. So we are going to replace those pipes. And when we get them out of the ground, we'll know what the problem is.
Yeah, so Vicki, you refer to that as the main line that serves the southwest sector. So
that's
all of my district, almost all of my district, right?
Your district and part of mine.
Yeah, so what happens if this line fails? Where's the backup?
Well, we have a we have put in interruption in Warrington for the south end of the county, where I guess you've heard about the tanks on Palafox.
Mm-hmm.
Those are for the downtown area. So we've got everything taken care of.
Yeah. So ECUA has a kind of a failover plan.
Oh, absolutely.
If any one part of it fails. But, you know, just like those tanks on Palafox, of course, there's been a lot of talk about that on social media. Without tanks like that, if something fails, what happens? If some part of the system fails and you don't have
those. If part of the system fails, then if we don't have tanks to put it in, then they have to use large bladders. And so they come in and put in, like, a cut out a piece of the pipe, a section of pipe, and put in large bladders until they can replace that part of the pipe.
So there's
not a very nice thing to look at.
No, that doesn't sound very pleasant.
But we always have a plan.
Yeah, but there's a couple of different, I guess, triage layers then.
Yes.
Emergency response.
Absolutely.
Okay, because that's, you know, it's funny how often, it's not funny, it's a little depressing, how often people say, well, you know, every time it rains, the sewer system fails. You know, and we have it happening over in Henderson Bayou right now. You know, that's really kind of the last area in my district where we consistently have that. And you guys always get the blame for it, and I guess it'd be easy for me to just say, well, let's just let them keep blaming ECUA. But the reality is, it's our stormwater system that's insufficient that then overwhelms and pours into your sewer system, right?
Exactly. Anytime the drainage overflows and that inflows into our system, then it causes a sanitary sewer overflow. So we're hardening our system, and that's only going to get worse for you. As we harden our system and make it not permeable, where your stormwater cannot flow in, then it won't have any place to go, so your flooding will get worse.
So while you're doing that hardening, and these things, I mean, it's insane, really, that in modern times, our stormwater system and our sewage system aren't completely separated. So as you're moving to harden it and separate that from the stormwater, we absolutely have to continue to push hard on getting our stormwater systems in those areas repaired and improved, because we're still kind of working on 1940s level technology. We did, after the 2014 flood, we had the Stormwater Action Team, and they came up with this huge list of things that they recommended that we do. And although it's not something that's going to get a whole lot of press in the Pensacola News Journal, because, you know, there's not the big ribbon cutting ceremonies, you know, it's stormwater, it's not real sexy, right? We've actually made a lot of progress on a lot of those things in that SWAT recommendation. So it is, you know, with each one of the storm events, it seems like it gets a little bit better, you know, but still quite a long ways to go. So I'm actually glad to see this kind of thing going in, because, you know, and just before this section, we were talking with Lois Benson down in Warrington about how much of Warrington and the West Side's commercial district is still on septic.
Yes.
Now, it is really hard to go to a company out of Arlington, Virginia, or a cyber company, and get them to come to Warrington when we don't even have a place for them to build an office that's not on a septic tank. So it's funny that we have. You know, now it's, you know, 2018, and we're talking about economic development. We're talking about economic development on the West Side, especially. Downtown has grown as much as it can. I mean, it's just booming and busting at the seams. All of that energy wants to come to the West Side. We just need to make sure the infrastructure is there for it. So when I see something like this happen, I see these pipes going in, I'm like, yes, that's the infrastructure that I can point at and tell anybody that's looking at the West Side. See, we're paying attention to the priorities.
We're making it better.
We are making it better. So anything else that you wanted to share about that project?
No, that project, when we get it, like I said, when we get the pipes out of the ground, we'll see what caused the problem and move forward knowing that and adjust, you know.
They make the adjustments.
Normally that doesn't happen. The corrosive part doesn't happen in an area like this. It's usually an area of high concentration, like a lift station where it's pumping up and over,
right.
And you have air release valves that let out the sulfuric acid, which everybody smells and calls you and me.
You always get the calls on that. It's funny, though, because you do get the calls about the lift stations. And what people think is when they smell that smell, that means the lift station's failing. And it doesn't. It means the lift station's doing exactly what it's supposed to do. Because if you don't vent that sulfuric acid, or the sulfur, out of the system, then what happens to it?
That's right. Explode. But yeah, that's right. I get the biggest calls from your district, not mine, but during tourist season, when every condo is full, the one on Perdido Key is always, you know, the air release valve goes off. And also the one here at South Bay, because this is a highly developed area. Mm-hmm. the contractor there put that lift station in the front of the subdivision, so they have to go by it every single time. It's got an air release valve, and that's what the people smell there, is that air release valve.
I get a lot of calls also of the lift station there at Gulf Beach Highway in front of Sea Glades. Mm-hmm. You know, and that's another area where, you know, you take a look on Google Earth and you see just how much density of homes there are in that area. Yeah, you know, and when you're talking about a coastal area like ours, there's just not a whole lot of lift.
Right.
There's not, you know, everything's flat. So when those things do vent off like that, that's the system working properly.
That's the system
so
working properly.
Instead of, well, you know, certainly it isn't a pleasant smell, but at least you should, as a citizen, recognize the system's working and
that's
working
right.
properly. So yeah. that's good stuff. Anything else? You know, what are you seeing in terms of what's kind of coming next from ECUA? And
well, you know, we're trying to move forward with a dirty MRF. We're working with the county. You know, I think that ball's being bounced around in both areas. That's my passion, to have a dirty MRF. So I hope we get there together.
It's so funny to see how much has gotten done in the last couple of years once the ECUA and the Board of County Commissioners realized, this is my swim lane, I'm doing this, that's your swim lane, you do that. We started cooperating and working together. A recycling facility, I know that was a big passion of yours. You know, I think a lot of your friends in your social circles were like, oh gosh, Vicki's talking about that darn recycling again. You just wouldn't stop talking about it, and that's why we have it. It's often easy in Escambia County to kind of dog cuss ourselves and talk about how backwards we've been in the past. Anybody who thinks that we're backwards, they need to go look at our recycling facility. The recycling facility that ECUA put together on county property, cooperation, that built that thing. And it is just constantly churning out recyclable product. And I was amazed in the joint ECUA Board of County Commissioners meeting we had, it's actually turning a profit.
Oh, yeah.
How often do you hear about anything in the government actually making money?
Well, and it's a big cost deterrent for our people. You know, for the ECUA customers, because they're not having to pay to bury it.
Right. I mean, every dollar, I mean, we all know that, you know, a dollar saved is a dollar earned. But if you're not only saving money, but also making money off of it, you know, that is an amazing, just such a good news story that just doesn't get talked about nearly enough.
Exactly. So,
well, again, thank you very much for your time coming out here.
Right.
And thanks for your continued there is never a time that there's not an issue that you're not picking up the phone and saying, Doug, here's how we see it from our side of the house, and here's what I think. You know, I know your position on everything that comes up long before I ever hear about it in the newspaper, and I really do appreciate that kind of cooperation.
I appreciate your cooperation.
Thanks, Vicki.
Thank you.
All right, so we've been looking at a couple of infrastructure items. I could literally do this for hours. We could probably spend all day just driving around the district and showing you infrastructure projects that we've done a good job on and infrastructure projects that we haven't gotten started on yet and we really need to. But I think the point is very clear that throughout the district, there are these issues. We're working on them. We've implemented so many of the issues out of the Stormwater Action Team that with each and every flood event, we see fewer and fewer houses put at risk, fewer and fewer businesses that have to close down because of it. But it's still not enough. We're not where we need to be, and the reason is because we're really not investing our time, energy, and money on our biggest priorities. The biggest priorities that I have as your county commissioner is infrastructure and public safety. Public safety, my job is to enable the sheriff, enable the firemen, enable your first responders to do their job. We're doing that. The thing that we're not doing enough of is investing in the infrastructure. If we will invest in the infrastructure and we create the environment for private sector investment, for private sector risk, and private sector prosperity, then we will have all the jobs that we need in Escambia County. We'll be the actual Escambia County that we know that we can be. So thanks for coming along on the trip, and help me focus this county with every discussion at your church, at the coffee shop, anywhere else. When they start saying, hey, you know, government ought to do something, if that something isn't government ought to do better on infrastructure, turn the conversation and let's make it about infrastructure. Ultimately, that's our number one job in Escambia County.